So imagine you're hearing something right now. What these drummers are doing is a lot of them, some of them are drumming at one rhythm and others are drumming at another rhythm, and it all sort of comes together to sound, as you can tell, pretty neat. And that has relatively little to do with my talk, but there's a slide that refers to it, so I thought I'd explain what it is that you're not hearing. Okay, I'm going to begin with some history. How many of you have read this document? Okay. It stirred up quite a fuss when it was published. Programmers and other worker bees identified with it, felt that it had been written for them, which is true enough. But I'm going to point out that it was also a marketing document, a bargain proposed by a new style of team to the business world. And here's the shape of the proposed deal. The teams promised the business two things. First, they promised to respond to changes from the business, and that's a fancy way of saying that they'd stop whining when the business changed requirements. Now, it's not that they were admitting that all those years of whining were some sort of unjustified passive-aggressive trick, as many people in the business world assumed. It's that the teams claimed that they now had the skills and the technologies to let them make software soft enough that they could quickly and correctly implement the requirements without caring whether they'd been created last week or last year. Next, the teams promised to care deeply about delivering working software. Again, the meaning of that was a little unclear. The teams were admitting that they knew that the business expected the following trajectory from every last project the business paid for. In January, the team says it'll be done in November. Then they more or less disappear from view, doing something, but it's not clear what. They pop up in September to alarm the business by admitting in a non-committal way that there's some schedule risk. In October, 1 month before the scheduled release date, they pop up again to admit the schedule will have to slip until, just before Christmas. Now, in the US, nobody gets anything done between Thanksgiving and Christmas, so the December date proves unrealistic. Finally, in January, system testing can start. According to the PERT chart, it will finish by the end of the month. Except that testing finds bugs. Bad bugs, showstopper bugs, and fixing them has pushed the release into February. Well, actually, March. And March is when the product finally limps into release many months late. That slow motion train wreck is what the business has come to expect. A long wait with disappointment at the end. So promises of working software don't mean a lot to the business. They don't trust their team. But the Agile Manifesto gives a different meaning to the phrase working software. What Agilists mean is that if the project starts in January, the business can, and indeed must, expect them to pop back up with working software no later than February. Now, I'm going to assume, because it makes the slides prettier, that we're talking about 1 month iterations, though 2 weeks is much more common these days. Now, working software means software that the business could, if it wanted, put into actual use. The software does at least one thing that's been chosen by the business that has real value. Or, if the business doesn't want to put the software into use, they can still try it out, unscripted, hands-on, to see if the software is saleable and convince themselves that the team is making progress. The team is no longer asking for trust, they're providing evidence, which is, of course, an excellent way to build trust. This process, the manifesto promises, could proceed month after month after month, stopping when the business decided it had enough value or at any arbitrary date it chose. Now, that progression of steady increments of value seems pretty implausible, but the manifesto claims it can now be done because teams now have the skills and the technology to do it. That's one half of the bargain. To make the whole deal work, the business has to do some things in return. First, they have to talk to the development team. And talk actually means spoken conversation, preferably face-to-face, and surprisingly often. In fact, I'm going to highlight that. The amount of communication required will surprise the business even after they think they're prepared for it. The second of the business's obligations is implicit in some of the lines in the manifesto. The unspoken message is, don't help us by telling us how to develop software. We, the team, realize that you, the business, have been scared because our work has been so invisible. So you put in checkpoints along the way to get early warning that things were going off track. But that didn't work. In fact, in a perverse way, it made things worse. The dirty little secret of software is that the process, the documents, always hindered the team's ability to respond to changing requirements. Trying and failing to reduce one problem increased another. However, we now have these skills and technologies to deliver frequent releases of working software, which is better evidence of progress than the documents that talk about what the software will be like when and if we finally get around to producing it. So, that was the deal. At first, not too many businesses took it, but now lots have, as witnessed the fact that we have this conference here and people will pay you money to come here. So, it's my opinion that the story of the Agile Manifesto is over, really. The time for marketing is past, and now what teams have to do is execute. And here the news is not so good. A lot of teams execute poorly, and helping you avoid their fate is what this talk's about. First, though, before I get to that, you'll notice that I have an emphasis on teams. Teams are what I know. The kind of consulting that I do involves embedding myself in a team and helping them out. While there's lots to be said about making the enterprise safe for agile, or for making the enterprise agile, or for doing other things involving the word enterprise, I'm not the person to say them. The person to say them is this gentleman, David Anderson, who, fortunately for you, will be giving a keynote on Thursday, which makes our talks nice bookends for the conference, because he does that enterprise stuff. Now, given what I've said before, you might expect that I'd be touting particular skills and technologies, and I'm not going to do that. I hope that you've sought them out in the tutorials of the last 2 days, you'll keep seeking them out in the next 2 days, and realize that you're going to have to keep learning these skills and technologies after you come back from the conference. So skills and technologies are essential, but I think that people know that. So instead, what I'm going to talk about are guiding values. So the question is, why am I going to spend the next 40 minutes of your time on that topic? It's because many of the problems I see in teams are due to people giving into temptation. Values are what keep us on the straight and narrow path in the face of temptation. Teams that have strong internalized values will stick to good agile practices and get good agile results, while teams without good values will drift into the ditch. Now, I'm using temptation in a broad sense. For example, I include allowing yourself to be bullied as most often a giving in to temptation, the temptation to be weak or to play it safe. For that reason, I'm going to name the first of the values courage, and I'm going to illustrate that with a story. How many people here are scrum masters? That's terrifying. How many people here work on teams with scrum masters? Okay. So you should appreciate this true story, which I heard from Ken Schwaber as a description of the kind of person a scrum master should be. So once there was a software team that was working in cubicles. They didn't like working in cubicles, which is an entirely sensible attitude. They wanted an open workspace. Now that makes a lot of sense given the amount of communication that happens in an agile team between team members and between team members and the business. However, the furniture police forbade the disassembly of cubicles. Company policy was cubicles, and company policy could not be changed for a single team, or else the entire fabric of the universe would be disrupted. Now, notice, by the way, that this is a picture of the actual furniture police. In any case, the team went through the usual lengthy arguments, and as usual, company policy prevailed. Until one weekend, the scrum master disassembled the cubicles and created an open workspace. Come Monday, she announced that if the cubicles were restored, she would immediately resign. That is courage, and that is what a scrum master is for. The job of the scrum master is to move immovable objects for the good of the team. Now, courage as a value was not present in the Agile Manifesto because that value wasn't relevant to the sales job. You don't want to tell businesses people will be breaking the rules. The next value, working software, was present because it's so important. As a guiding value, it says that if you don't know what to do, if you think you're going astray, always err on the side of getting some software, doing something that someone can look at. Now, I don't have a story exactly to illustrate that, but I do have a guideline from Kent Beck. As you probably know, people, and especially programmers, are prone to having long design discussions about what to do next, about what the appropriate approach should be. A great many of those discussions are wastes of time. The fewer facts people have, the harder they argue, it seems. So Beck made up a guideline. Here it is. No design discussion should last more than 15 minutes without someone turning to a computer to do an experiment. The assumption underlying this guideline is something like this. Humans, with their experience augmented by watching or writing code, are smarter than humans standing alone. And that humans plus running code are smarter than humans plus time spent talking. I'm convinced that books could be written about this worldview, and in fact, books have been written about it, they just don't mention software. For now, though, I'll stop with the guiding value. Whenever you're doing something that's starting to irritate you, and that something does not involve the immediate making or observing of running code, find a way to add working software to the mix. Now, I used the word irritation deliberately because it's a bridge to the next of the guiding values, ease. I'm going to start my explanation with a dead philosopher. This is Martin Heidegger, who is a truly odious man, but someone who coined a useful distinction. Consider the act of hammering. There are two ways you could experience the hammer while hammering, according to Heidegger. It could be what he called ready to hand. In that case, you don't think about the hammer, you think about hammering. You're not really conscious of the hammer at all, you're conscious of the goal, the object of the task, in this case, making that nail go into that board. On the other hand, the hammer could be what Heidegger called present to hand, in which case you're constantly aware of the hammer, typically because there's something wrong with it, something that's putting the goal at risk. Maybe the head on the hammer is loose, so it feels like it'll fly off if you swing the hammer too hard. Because of that, you constantly have to attend to something that's normally automatic or ready to hand. You'll always be feeling the hammer present in your hand. Here's another example. I'm told by a surgeon that if you have a good surgical nurse, you put out your hand and magically the right instrument appears in it, it's ready to hand. You focus on the operation, you maybe vocalize what you're doing, and the tools simply are there to help you do what you need. Suppose, in contrast, the surgeon had to search for the right instrument in something like our kitchen drawer. Now the surgery is made less easy by the present-to-handness of some peripheral activity. Here's an example of peripheral activities in software. I needed to fix a particular bug. To reproduce it, I had to find a Windows Vista machine, but they were all allocated to other people, so I had to upgrade from Windows XP. In order to do that, I needed more memory, so I had to buy more memory, but that meant I needed to get approval from my manager, Frida, but she was angry with me because of a little incident that was fresh in her memory. So I had to find some way to even out her opinion of me by delighting her in some way, perhaps with a present. I remembered she was knitting an old-style Doctor Who scarf using rare and exotic animal hair, which is how I ended up at the zoo shaving a yak, which I needed to do to fix that bug. Now, I didn't come up with this phrase. The phrase yak shaving has entered the software jargon, and one online dictionary defines it as any seemingly pointless activity which is actually necessary to solve a problem, which solves a problem, which several levels of recursion later solves the real problem you're working on. This kind of thing happens in software all the time, and it kills productivity. And a characteristic of high-performing agile teams seems to be how much they value ease of work. So for example, someone working in some code that's awkward for some reason will spend a little time making that code easier for the next person who has to work in it. If the build keeps breaking, someone, not necessarily the designated build czar, will do a little bit of error proofing to make it harder for people to accidentally break the build. If exploratory testing requires too much tedious manual setup, a programmer might put a shortcut in the app for the testers. How many people here are testers? How many of you have ever had a programmer change the code to make your testing easier? Okay, a few. That's good. Most people do not expect that. It was completely foreign to my experience before I began working on agile teams. So all of this is a good example of how a guiding value works. It's always a temptation to skip doing something in the short term if that short term thing only pays off in the long term. But if you believe down to your core that you deserve a pleasant experience, that your work experience, that your focus on your task should not be diverted by the present-to-handness of everything you want to bring to bear on that task, then your software will get progressively easier to work with. This attitude counters a problem that I see reasonably often in new agile projects. They start out with a burst of productivity. They're actually delivering software each and every iteration. The business is ecstatic because they've never seen value delivered quickly before. But as time goes on, the trend line is toward less and less value per iteration. The software is becoming rigid, just like all the proponents of big design up front told us it would. I believe that if you attend to the ease of your moment-to-moment work, your whole project will be pulled toward the malleability or softness that's essential to delivering on the manifesto's promise. This kind of malleability, I think, both allows and is built upon being reactive. Now, that's odd, since it's not respectable to be reactive. We're supposed to be proactive in all things. So let me tell another story. I needed help 3, 4, 5 years ago with a persistent problem. As a programmer, I'd have planned out a certain path toward a coding goal, and I'd have coded some way along that path when I realized things weren't working out. I was getting irritated. I was getting unsure of myself. The sensation I get when I feel like code is going wrong is sort of an itching sensation. Now, having been taught something by the working code that I was writing, I now saw a new, better path that I should have taken. But to take it now, I'd have to undo what I'd done, some of what I'd done, which is fairly error-prone. Of course, version control systems let you take a snapshot so that you can automatically and flawlessly jump back to a previous state of the code like this, and then you restart from that point. Problem was, I never made snapshots at the right places, so I never had the right places to jump back to. So I was at a conference reception, and I asked John Johansson, a better programmer than I am, who also lives in Utah, how he decided when to take snapshots to back up to, because I was sure he had the secret. And he surprised me by saying, I never back up. I just bend the code toward the better solution. I hear this metaphor of bending a lot when I talk to agile people. Rather than spending too much time predicting the future, you take a stab at doing something and then react to what you learn from writing and running the code, always flexibly moving toward a goal. The agile belief is that on average, this being reactive to events in an uncertain world where you have to constantly respond to change wins over priding yourself at being proactive. This is sometimes referred to as waiting until the last responsible moment to make a decision. Of course, knowing when the last responsible moment is a matter of skill. So is knowing how to write software that's soft enough that you can keep pushing the last responsible moment later and later, closer to release. I'm going to show you an example of such skill because it illustrates another guiding value, fast feedback. Getting those little twinges, those itchy feelings that tell you you're on the wrong track, that it's time to react. Back in school, at least until recently, we were taught that when you're building a software system, the first thing you build is the infrastructure, and the infrastructure is the hard part, the cool part. Once you got that done, you just add features, pop, 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 which ought to be pretty easy now because you took the time to get the infrastructure right. Took the time seems like a different thing than fast feedback. So let's see what that looks like using our calendar pages. You might spend 3 weeks of a month-long iteration doing some sort of infrastructure for the features of that iteration. Only after the infrastructure is done do you implement the first feature. And what might that implementation tell you? It might tell you that you got the infrastructure wrong. But now you've wasted a lot of time. There's only 1 week left. You're so far off track now that bending toward the right solution is too hard, and you have to backtrack and blow the iteration. Or, maybe worse, it's only when you finish the first feature in the fourth week of the iteration that you get to ask the business, is this what you meant? And from their answer, you might discover that you have a fundamental misunderstanding of what they were getting at. But now it's kind of too late. The end of the iteration is again upon you. No time to finish what you promised you'd do for them in exchange from the wheelbarrow loads of cash that they shovel your way. Infrastructure-first development is a recipe for sudden big surprises that make you, the business, your friends and family, all doubt whether you know what you're doing. For that reason, agile teams usually develop differently, and I'm going to show you an example of that, but first a note. Real agile development is like the drumming you pretend you heard at the beginning. It consists of different threads and themes, each moving at its own cadence, but all working together and synchronizing periodically, most especially at the end of the iteration. One of the problems outsiders often have with Agile is that it looks so disorderly. You walk into the team room and it looks like chaos, but from the inside you can see how everything meshes. So to avoid the appearance of chaos, I'm going to show the new style development in a simplified, serialized form. The team starts with one feature. They finish it. They rush off to the business representative, the person, remember, who's talking to them all the time, and they get the feedback that they crave. Now they add a second feature. But before they go rushing off to show that to the business, another value takes hold, and that's ease. They've probably made the code less easy to work with, in no small part because there's too much of it. They'll find that the two features have things in common, so there's code that they should share, like this. Now the code is easier to work with. There's been a slight delay before showing the second feature to the business representative, a slight delay in feedback, but it's worth the cost. There are always trade-offs among values. This process continues until the end of the iteration. What's interesting is that if you have the skill to develop software in what's called vertical slices and to generalize by removing duplication, you can end up with this, an app with infrastructure. In fact, an infrastructure that looks like it was designed by a fantastically good designer who built exactly and only what was needed by the feature set with no wasted motion at all. That's a nice result. You get to the same place that you supposedly got via big design up front, via fast feedback route, but with less danger along the way. But still, we're talking about feedback cycles, perhaps days in length. And to a fast feedback attitude, that kind of feedback is scarily slow. What's comfortable is feedback every few minutes, as you get with a particular skill called test-driven design. If you have this skill, in brief, you describe what you want to accomplish in, say, the next 5 minutes, you write the code to accomplish it, then you ask the computer to check whether you did what you said you'd do. This kind of fast feedback measured in minutes is what agile people value, and they will constantly be pushing for faster feedback in all aspects of the work. I believe that in doing so, they're often showing how much they value naivete, a sort of foolish innocence that willfully denies the idea that software has to be rigid. Now, I realized the power of naivete back when test-driven design became popular, around, I think, 2000, thereabout-ish. I'd had extensive experience teaching programmers to unit test in the early to mid-90s, and also had experience with other kinds of test automation. Based on that experience, I confidently decreed that test-driven design would fail. In particular, I predicted that test suites would not be maintained, that almost all of them would be abandoned after no more than 2 years, and so would test-driven design. It would be abandoned just as the last fad for programmer testing had been in the early 90s. The reason, I said, was that changing test suites to match feature and code changes would be too much work. Well, I was wrong. I was way wrong, as it turns out. Now, the interesting question is, why would such an experienced and sophisticated gentleman such as myself be so fantastically wrong? What happened that I was unable to imagine would happen? What happened was that the programmers looked at what made unit testing irritating, difficult, and unmaintainable, and it was the structure of the code, which I had always assumed was just part of the unchangeable fabric of the universe. And they changed it. They changed the way they programmed because they demanded ease and fast feedback. And it was as if they believe that software, including tests, not only can be soft, but wants to be soft, wants to be maintainable, and all that's required is to discover the right skills and technologies to unleash that latent potential and let that malleability out. This sort of naive, utopian attitude works out amazingly often. When you value malleability enough to make the effort, and when you're naive enough to try what experience and the experienced tell you can't possibly work. This naivete in Agile extends to more than just software. As an example of it, I'll use another value, visibility. In some sense, visibility goes along with fast feedback. There's no feedback without new information, and it doesn't even make sense to talk about new information that you can't see. But Agile teams tend to make visibility spill over into outright exhibitionism. One reason is that it's often the case that the mere exposure of a problem is enough to see it solved. For example, there was a team who believed in pair programming, having programmers work in pairs to write code. What they noticed was that certain people tended to work together over and over instead of pairing with other people in the team. Now, intellectually, everybody agreed that that was a bad habit because it inhibits the diffusion of knowledge that pair programming is known for. But knowing something intellectually and acting on it are two different things. They could have solved the problem prescriptively in a command and control way by making a schedule that explicitly mixed people up. Instead, they just made the problem visible by putting up this chart, which has all the programmers across the top and all of them down the side. And every time you paired with someone, you were supposed to tick off your slot on the chart. And the gaps in the chart made their bad habits constantly obvious. Like JV, for example, is either on vacation or doesn't ever pair. And this was what Alistair Coburn calls an information radiator. And that alone, the mere presence of that chart was enough to increase the diversity of their pairing with no mandates required. There's an implicit assumption here, one about humans and not about software. It is that humans, not just software, can be soft, can be malleable. And I think that's important. You see, the dominant way of thinking about change is that people are set in their ways, that major change requires a crisis. And certainly it's the case that many organizations switch to Agile because of a crisis. However, the Agile attitude seems to deny the necessity of a crisis, the big fuss, and all the techniques needed to shepherd people through a crisis to improvement. Just make bad habits visible enough. The pressure of constant visibility will make you lay those habits aside, and over time, what you do instead will themselves become habits, but this time, good habits. And over time, this collection of changes can grow great team members and great teams exactly in the way that the product grows smoothly from something barely functional to something to be proud of. I like this emphasis on steady growth over crisis-driven change, no matter how naive and utopian it seems, because it's getting toward the last of the Agile values I want to talk about. One that is so out of place, so shameful, that I barely dare utter its name. Joy. Here's the thing. If you talk to the people who wrote the Agile Manifesto, eventually most of them will make reference to that one great project that they were on some point in the past that made them think, this is the way software ought to be done. These other ways are insane. And the fact that the way it ought to be done was so rarely done is what turned these people into evangelists for Agile software development. And I tell you, it was an enormous pleasure early in the days of Agile consulting to go on a consulting gig and hear both programmers and the business people say, "This is the greatest project I've ever worked on." There was a point, in fact, where I was talking to Mike Cohn about this, and I told him that my reaction to hearing that was getting to be, yeah, heard it before, let's move on, because so many people were raving about it. And that's what worries me. As Agile is becoming widespread, as it's taking hold in larger and more mainstream companies, I'm starting to hear a different reaction. At least my job doesn't suck as much as it used to. Ladies, gentlemen, and others, this is not a lofty goal. I think that you deserve better. I think that if you have the courage to frankly bend your work in a joyful direction, when you have that choice, while still always producing working software at frequent intervals, you can do better than a job that doesn't suck. However, I'm envisioning you going back to wherever it is you work and your boss asking you what you got out of the conference and you replying, joy. Joy is too embarrassing to mention in a business setting, so we'll just keep it among ourselves. Which of the other guiding values would I like you to concentrate on? It's ease. As I travel around different projects, I see them spending their time shaving yaks, solving, but just for today, problems that are keeping them away from solving their real problems. I see them using tools or skills or technologies or techniques that are always going to be awkward, but not being naive enough to try to fix them. And I see them thinking that their environment, the context of their work, those 300,000 lines of legacy code, those damn DBAs, the furniture police, the company's implementation of Sarbanes-Oxley are all something that they have to put up with, something that they will be driven by rather than something they can and should change. Now, I know high-performing agile teams would not put up with that. I know they would immediately start adding ease into their work. Now, do I know that they're high-performing teams because they add ease into their work? No, I believe it. I can't prove it, and you can't prove it either. But what you can do in your work is lean toward ease, bend your work toward ease, and watch what happens. If what you see and make visible is something like this, signs that the combination of the team and the code are getting steadily better at producing value, I think the business has no cause to complain that your work seems to be going too smoothly, that you're not struggling, that you seem to be having a good time. Remember, it's part of the manifesto's original deal that the business doesn't get to tell you how to make software, just as you don't tell them that the features they want are the wrong features, so you're going to give them something else. Now, I believe strongly enough that, you know, the magic secret sauce to Agile is ease at work, that I've made up some posters and brought some here to give you, and they're down in front here in the suitcase. If you don't get one and you want one, send me mail to that address, and I'll send you a poster for free until I either run out of posters or get tired of going to the post office. Okay, with that, I thank you. We're not going to have quite the usual question period now. Instead, and imagine King Crimson polyrhythmic music playing right now. Instead, I want to get together a little panel of people who know more about Agile than I do, so they can tell me what values I missed or what values I included that don't belong, or tell stirring stories of teams putting values into use. So I invite up to the podium Jeff Patton, Rachel Davies, Linda Rising, J.B. Rainsberger, Anthony Marcano, and David Hussman, and we'll talk for a second. So what do you guys think? Is there something to Agile besides skills and technologies and the like?
Well, I'd like to tell a brief story of one of the first times that I really understood what it meant to deliver a minimum marketable feature. I was a programmer by trade at the beginning of my career, and I still am one now, but much less so than I used to be. But one of the things that really impressed me about some of the ideas in Agile was the first time I needed to write software to solve my own business problems. I used to run small conferences, nothing like this, and I needed a way to collect money because it's really an integral part of running a conference unless you want to go broke. And the first time that I talked with someone about building a conference registration system, well, you can imagine how that conversation would go, right? Everyone on this stage and probably out there, you have the image in your mind of a programmer who, if you asked them for a conference registration system, would give you something in a year that did everything that you never wanted to do. So what I did instead was think about what does it take to collect money. And my conference system went like this. Here's six fields. Enter your name and your address so that I know where to contact you. Tell me whether you want Indian buffet or the salad bar. Tell me whether you're going to allow me to publish your email address and in the proceedings and push OK. And that would send me a little email that would tell me to go into PayPal and give you a money request. And would you believe that collected more than enough money to pay for the budget of the conference and told me that the only thing I needed to do to make my work easier was automate the really simple PayPal transactions. So instead of spending a year, I spent a week and was able to build enough software to run five conferences. So that, to me, I think as programmers, if we could step into the customer's shoes a little bit and understand really how little it can take to impress them and allow them to turn the tap on and start making money, we might build a little less complexity into our work.
Okay. I'd like to begin with an appreciation just for being here and just for having the chance to hear your talk. I always learn a lot from you, and you always cause me to think. So I appreciate you for that.
Thank you.
As I was thinking of sort of matching teams that I've worked with against your template of values to see if there was anything missing or anything I could possibly add, and I'm struggling with a team right now, and it seems like maybe there is something missing. I like the visibility entry in your list, but one thing that can happen on a team is maybe we could call it delusion, that we don't know what should be visible, that everyone steps around some pretty obvious truth, that everyone is afraid to call that out for some reason. So maybe it's a combination of lack of visibility, lack of courage, but that everyone buys into that and everyone is still pretty happy except for some unease. So I don't know whether it's a combination of missing all those values or maybe a missing value itself, which is failure to see, recognize, honor the truth. I don't know.
I see a lot of agile teams that are kidding themselves. They go through the motions of making the burned out chart and the story cards, but they're taking on too much work and they can't get it all done. One of the things that they need to know how to do is to be able to say no, to show that they can not deliver everything, and to actually engage the customer in discussion about what they should be building. And I think all too often I see it become a process, so where it's just like we follow these steps. So I'd like to see questioning as the value. So the value for me is asking questions.
A lot of teams have one person who is sort of often not experienced, often talented, often socially inept, often male. Those two kind of go together. And very brash. And I used to consider it my job to sort of dampen them down until they got enough sense not to damage themselves with the way they presented things. But more recently, I've been sort of trying to build those people up as, because they are the people who are constantly dissatisfied with the things everybody else thinks are fine. And people just go, you know, this person is an idiot, unless you can find a way to somehow get the value from them while not killing them.
So that's a good bridge. The two values that I wrote down were angst and purpose. The angst being this weird feeling of, at a previous employer, I got the label of glass half empty guy, simply because while other people seem to be happy with the way things were, I could always see that this could be a little bit better, or things were making me tense or anxious. And this constant things could be better that isn't necessarily easy or joyful sometimes always sort of led to things getting easier and joyful. It wasn't the pursuit of ease or joy, it was the elimination of angst that ended up driving a lot of my behavior. And then I wrote down purpose, because not knowing why I'm doing something, or not knowing that I'm going to be delivering software to somebody who will benefit from doing it, I'm not in it for the work, I'm in it to know that I'm doing something that's valuable to people. So it's same things, but those are the things that strike me.
I corresponded once with someone. They were doing extreme programming. They were doing 1 week iterations. And he told me that their product owner, their customer in XP lingo, refused to tell them anything about what was coming next week. He would give them the stories for this week, and then he would give them no clue as to what was coming down the pike. And so they really had no idea what they were building. And I asked him, is this a problem? And he said, as far as the technical efficiency, no, it doesn't matter to us that we don't know what's coming down, but we hate him. So that's because they didn't really they didn't know the purpose. They were just on this treadmill of implement.
So I want to start by saying, after many auditions, it's pretty cool to finally be in King Crimson. I'm trying for years, but this Fripp guy always got in the way. Secondly, it's tough to be at the end of this row, because there's a lot of experience up here. And if I added something to the Agile Manifesto, it would be a line like success over dogma, or description over prescription. And what I think you're hearing that's really cool up here that I would maybe add, Brian, is experience. That some of the worst agile implementations out there are where people are walking in and saying, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do that. And all the people I know, like this set of sages up here, tend to walk in and say, here's what I've seen work. These guys are kind of like you, they tried this. And people are telling their stories, not just user stories, coaching stories, leadership stories. And then we don't have to worry about what a Scrum Master is. A Scrum Master could be someone that gets people telling their experiences, agile or not, because there's a lot of people that have great experiences that aren't agile. The first company I worked at, we did a lot of pair programming, but we just called it working together. That tended to work out fairly well for us. Yeah. So experience would be what I would add.
Wow, I have to go after all of that. So I think, first of all, this list, courage, working software, ease, reactive, fast feedback, naivete, and I especially like naivete. I like the way you put that across. Visibility and joy. I think we need to get those values listed next to the Agile Manifesto as soon as possible. That needs to be there. I think there are so many teams that need this. There's only one I think that might possibly be missing. And I think that there are still aspects of these values that are presenting how we intend to work with the customer. And I think now we have more values to focus on how we should be working with each other. Yet things like joy can sometimes be interpreted as being a selfish value, my personal joy. And I think community spirit is something that probably needs to be a big part of that. Something I've noticed about all the most successful Agile teams I've worked on, we were a family. We were not individuals who were there to make as much more money than the next guy. We were a family working together for our mutual benefit. We weren't trying to individually outdo the next person. And I think joy, or community joy, or family joy, or team joy, maybe. Or maybe it just needs to be a separate value, a community or family spirit within the team. So yesterday, Brian, we were talking about naivete, and you told me a story about a bee that I think really got the message across so powerfully. Can you just share with us the story about the bee and flight?
OK. Okay, I think I probably told it better then. There was wine involved. There's a poem, I'm not sure who it's by. I think it was by Ogden Nash. And there was some aerodynamic person at one point calculated that it's impossible for bumblebees to fly. And that was a big deal for a while. And the poem is about how the bumblebee can't really fly, but the bumblebee doesn't know it can't fly, so it flies perfectly happily. It was better.
That was fine. That's exactly it. And that just hammered the message home to me, because I didn't get it at first, and it was the fact that if I don't know that I can't do something, then maybe I'll just try and do it.
It turns out that the bumblebee can fly because they have a little twist in their wings that gives them the additional lift, just in case you were worried about it. Okay. Thank you all.